Ace.
Mickey Free, how are you?
Oh, man, I'm burning it. I'm tired, man. I got to get on the road tomorrow and head out to Las Vegas to sell my thing, you know. But I'm alive and well. How you doing, WB?
I'm doing great, man. I'm just so grateful to finally catch up with you and want to thank you up front for sharing your time with Tales from the Sunset Strip.
Well, I mean, you know, me and you got a lot of tales that we can share, Willie Bates.
Mickey Free. Wow.
Yeah, man. Yeah. You know, the 80s were hard on us, man. Or should I say the 80s were nice to us, as we are both know and can appreciate. From the bands to the girls to the guitars, to Simmons to Stanley, you know, and all of our friends, man.
Yep.
You know, we were rocking in those days, man, when Poison and London and Motley, before they were Motley, you know, all of our friends, man. Everybody was at the Rainbow trying to do it, Willie. You know that. You know that. I want to tell you.
Yeah, it's. I often say, you know, you would have to have been there, you know. You would have had to be there. Because you can't describe it the way it really was, you know, with the just sidewalks wall to wall full of people. And
no, you're right. I mean, you had to live it. I mean, really, some of the, you know, I think the best representation of what we lived and how we did what we did, you know, you being a premier bassist and everybody knowing you as one of the black premier cats, but no color was ever associated with it because you were just a straight rocker, man. And me the same way, as a mixed blood Native American cat, no one ever really questioned our color because we could rock, man. We were like the real deal.
Yeah.
You know, and yeah, I mean, there's no doubt about it. People to this day in London, you know, they ask me, you know, about, you know, my tone and the way I play, you know, because it's pure, you know, and it's because we grew up on Zeppelin and Kiss and Aerosmith and Tommy Bolin and ZZ, you know, and that's how we learned how to play, man. You know, not coming in the other door, the R&B door, which I love, as you know, and you love.
Yeah.
But we did. We came in through the rock door, you know, and you know, that's why our friends are like Billy Gibbons, and I was discovered by Gene Simmons and produced by Paul Stanley, and, you know, that whole deal, man. It's just, when they found us, including yourself, it was just two cats that could play. It looked different, and, you know, it was a plus, you know, and that's the way it was, and, you know, I think being weird today is still cool.
Yeah, man, so I'm very excited, and I know that my brothers, my family down in Texas are very excited to know that Shalimar's back together and you guys are playing again. That's just awesome. How is Howard?
He's great, man. I mean, Howard, is, as you know, and as the world knows him, and you know, he's one of my best friends. He's a premier singer, man. I mean,
he's one of the most talented people on the earth.
No doubt. He's got that voice like red velvet cake, and, you know, oh, yeah, man. And he's just a down cat. And when I joined Shalimar, you know, they were really straight up R&B. Then when your boy joined, you know, we had that smash Dancing in the Sheets, crossed over pop right away, triple platinum. You know, me and Steve Stevens became good friends because I was swinging through, busting through windows on MTV. Really,
I love that video. I love that.
That was crazy, man.
Classic.
Yeah, man. Matt Swarm and all those guys are going, dude, was that really you? You know, busting through that window. And Steve Stevens, man, he was my biggest fan. He was like, bro, that's like Zorro, man. He was like, loved it.
I was like, that's my boy.
Yeah, and being, you know, and so, you know, and, you know, I'm doing my own solo thing. Howard does his own solo thing. But, you know, we had a meeting about a year ago, and there was just like no reason, man, that Shalimar, one of the biggest R&B bands, pop bands of the 80s, shouldn't be doing, you know, what everybody else is doing, is coming back around, you know, doing Native American casinos, going out on these tours with his 3 and 4 bands from the 80s that was huge. And, you know, just like the rock and roll thing.
Yeah.
And Howard was like, down. He's like, yeah, man, it's a great idea, Free. And you know, when we were together, when I was in Shalimar back in the, you know, 80s, man, that was, shoot, that was 10 years, 15 years. Then Howard left the band, and I was the lead singer of the group, really. And I ran Shalimar for, you know, 4 or 5 years. And then, you know, Simmons got into the picture, and we went to Interscope, and, you know, Ted Shields and Jimmy Iovine signed me and Jean Dubois, as you know.
Yeah.
Then, you know, Grandma Thorne and Tony Thompson, man. You know, it's crazy. But it's going to be fun with Shalimar. It's going to be different. You know, I'm a down-home blues rock, Jimmy-influenced guitar player. That's what I mean. You can relate to each other. That's what I really do. You know, Shalimar is my gig where I can just get pure R&B injection and be part of a band and not have to worry about, you know, everything. Because Howard Hewitt is the voice of Shalimar. And, you know, there's only three of us. You know that, Willie. It's just me and Howard. And, you know, the new girl, Carolyn Griffey, who was Dick Griffey's daughter, Willie, that owned Solar Records. Remember him?
Yeah, of course. But I didn't know that was his daughter. It's amazing.
His daughter. And she is the new girl singer in Shalimar. And, you know, I hate to say this, but she is super bad. Super fine, baby.
Cool.
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. So we're going to start at the Riviera Hotel in Vegas on Saturday night. And it's old. It's called the Old School Jam, Willie, and it's with like Rose Royce, Sherelle, Rob Bass, and then Shalimar's headlining. And it's going to be like wicked fun, man. You know,
that's going to be off the hook.
Yeah, I'm really thrilled, Willie. That I just, you know, because as you know, Shalimar's three principal members, okay, and then there's like a 67 piece band. You know how we do, behind us.
Yeah.
So I just have to play a little guitar solo and dead giveaway and stuff like that, smile and have some fun, man. which is, yeah, I'm looking forward to it, Willie Bass.
Well, you know, that's what I love about you, man, is that you can shift gears and you know what I mean? It's not like you're a one-trick pony. You've got different sides to you, but it's all soulful, and that's what I love.
Well, man, thank you, Willie. Thank you, man. Takes one to know one, you know, as we know. But you know what? You know, this is weird, Willie. I think I kind of, this is so crazy, but I think I kind of got that whole vibe. You know, I mean, Gene Simmons used to say to me, you know, you're not a one-trick pony, Mickey Free, and you're not just another pretty face. I love that about Simmons when he said that. Mm-hmm. You know, he said, and I still use this quote today in my bio, Mickey Free is a Jimi Hendrix innovator, not a Jimi Hendrix impersonator. Because there's only one Jimmy. There never will be another one. I don't play like Jimmy, but I am definitely channeling my man, as everyone seems to think, and that's the way I roll that way, you know?
Yeah.
That's just what I do.
But it's real.
I'll tell you one story that just is so cool that made me just love, you know, the funk and rock and roll, because these cats do it with no color, Willie. Who, and you know what I'm going to say, Led Zeppelin and Aerosmith.
Yep.
Those guys are so funky, as you know.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
With John Bonham and Steven Tyler, man, those guys know what funk is, but they channel it through that rock, man, which is just a 2 and 4, you know?
Yeah.
Boom, bow, boom. Bah, AC/DC, boom, bah, boom, bah.
And it's universal. There's no boundaries. When you go there, it transcends all boundaries. You know.
There's no denying that heavy foot, like Tony Thompson, like Cindy Blackman, like John Bonham, like, you know, there's so many drummers that we've known, Guinea Apathy that I've played with. I mean, you know, forget it, man. These guys are great. And they get, you know, the backbeat.
Yeah.
Rock and roll, man, is the backbeat. Drums is the bloodline, Willie Bass. We know this. It's bass players like you, and it's good drummers that make rock and roll happen. Because, you know, in my three-piece band, as you know, who's Cindy Blackman Santana and Dave Santos in American Horse, I can't do my thing without them guys holding down the fort, WB, you know that. They have to, man.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
What I love about Cindy Blackman is, you know, she's like Mitch Mitchell, man. She knows Cindy can just go to, you know, the dark side of the moon. But when we have to come back on that one, she's there. Baby. That's what I love about her, man. And I'll tell you, she's, as you know, I mean, she's just a fantastic person, you know. I mean, me and her and Carlos have become pretty good friends. And, you know, fingers crossed, there's a project I'm going to be doing with Carlos next year that Cindy hooked up.
What's it called again? What cross?
Well, there's no name for it, and it's kind of one of those hush-hush things. But I met with Carlos Santana. I met with Cindy Blackman, who was his wife, as you know. And we talked about doing this project that Carlos is going to do next year, which is going to be that. As soon as Light of Day comes, you know I'll be calling you, put this out in your Tales from the Sunset Strip. I will be dialing. I'll be WB. I got something to talk about, you know?
Well, cool. I want to do some bass for you, too, man, on something, somewhere we got to hook up.
No doubt. I mean, I reached out to you for Paladinos. You were too busy. I get it. I know that you couldn't come down, but man, you would have loved it, man. You know, Sin from Ministry jumped up and played Voodoo Child with me. Willie, it was ridiculous.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. He's a good friend of mine. And, you know, Sin, I've known him forever. And he hit me on Facebook. He said, bro, I see you're going to, like, be jamming at Paladino's doing a one-off. He says, you know I'm your boy. I want to come down and see you. I said, I'll give you one better than that, man. Come and play Voodoo Child Slight Return with me. Dude, it's all over Facebook, you know, in video form. You got to check it.
Cool.
You got to check it, Willie. I mean, we burned it down. I mean, I love Sin. Just killer guitar player.
Well, you know, when I sent out the press release that I was going to be interviewing you, I mean, it was so much love came back immediately. I mean, within 4 to 6 hours, I was getting flood results, and the people just love you here and in Europe, and I'm getting response from all over the world that you are definitely loved, my brother. I don't know if you're aware of that, but I needed to let you know.
You know what? Like, thank you. Thank
really
you
good response.
Thank you for telling me that, Willie, because, you know, I got to be honest, man. You know, what rock and roll and kind of what we do, I kind of never, you don't think about that, really. You know, you just try to put your best foot forward, as we've done, the best we can, and then you keep on rocking, baby, you know?
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, Jean Beauvoir called me this morning, WB, this morning.
Really?
Yes, man. He was my first call of the day because, you know, he's in Florida. So Jean called me at 8:30, so that's six, his time. I mean, he's nuts. I call him Voodoo Man because, you know, he's Haitian.
Yeah, yeah.
And Voodoo called me and he goes, I got news, you got to call me. And so, I mean, I'm telling you this, and you're going to be the first to know. I mean, and it's going to be on your show, which is very cool, that next year, me and Jean are probably going to head out to something in London first, and we're going to do acoustic shows. It's called Beauvoir Free. And it's just going to be me and Jay, yeah, man, me and Sean, a couple acoustic guitars. We're going to do shows first, 5 or 6 in London, England, the island. We're going to head over to Europe.
Wow.
And, yeah, man, you know, I thought of the idea. I go, Sean, you know, Crown of Thorns, you know, our record was huge over there, you know, and the, our songwriting ability, Jean and I, Ted Fields and Jimmy Iovine used to call us the short order cooks because we could write like a hit song, man, in like one day.
Yeah,
I mean,
whip it out, baby.
A few hours. You know how that goes.
Yeah, man.
So Jean called me and goes, man,
you gotta eat,
man.
You gotta eat.
Yeah. Yeah. He said, are you down? And I said, let's do it, man. Let's put it together. So they've got interest in, you know, Scandinavia, Germany, in England. And it's just going to be me and Jean.
Man, that's awesome.
Right, man? I love that
idea.
Yeah,
that's like, so I could just see it so intimate and personal, you know, the fans, they're going to love it. They'll love it.
You know, and doing stuff from Crown of Thorns, stuff that he wrote with Kiss, stuff that I wrote for Kiss, you know, Mickey Free solo stuff, you know, Jean, you know, drums along the Mohawk stuff. It's going to be kind of an interesting show. We got a bunch of really good material, man.
Uh-huh.
You know, I've got to get you my new DVD. It's not even released yet. With Bill Wyman from the Stones playing bass, live in Hyde Park. Okay.
Wow.
Yeah, man. 100,000 people, and we're doing. You're gonna love this. Jumpin' Jack Flash and Red House by Hendrix, and it is crazy. Bill Wyman. What is? I mean, that's freaky. I shit the bed, Willie. What? I mean, I met Bill through Little Steven when we were in Europe on Hard Rock Calling Festival about 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Me and Bill Wyman have been friends ever since. Our families as well. You know, I go back to England and I hang with Bill. I have dinner with him every time I'm there, and you know, he jammed with me at Hyde Park, and it was unbelievable. Unbelievable, Willie.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
I mean, a Rolling Stone. I mean, what?
He's really a heavy, heavy blues collector. I mean, he knows about the blues, that guy.
Yes, he does. Let me tell you something. He's got a book out, a few books, but he's got Bill Wyman's Blues Odyssey. That's the one you're talking about.
Mm.
And he gave it to me and signed it. I read that on the plane ride home 1 year from London. I got to tell you, man, you know this already, but for people that hear this, the Rolling Stones almost single-handedly saved black blues in America in the 60s. We know this, Willie, you know?
Because didn't they go to Chess Records and
exactly.
Yeah, man, and then
they went to and then they Muddy took, Waters.
Put Muddy Waters back to Europe with them or something.
Yep, totally. Yep, you're right on it. You're right on it. Their name, the Rolling Stones, the Muddy Waters song, man, you know?
Yeah.
And those guys, man, I mean, to me, man, you know, the rub shoulders, I mean, come on. I mean, to be discovered by Gene Simmons and mentored by Gene for over 20 years and Paul, that's pretty heavy duty for a turkey like me, number one. Then you befriend a Rolling Stone, okay? And that's like royalty to me in England, you know? And then you got Billy Gibbons as ZZ Top giving me his own guitar off of his neck, a Billy Bow guitar. And then Joe Perry now will be digging my American Horse CD with Cindy Blackman. And I could, not that I want to die, but if I click tomorrow, I live a good one, man. So you know this. Yeah. Not that I want to check out, but you know.
Yeah, I hear you. I hear you, man. You've been blessed.
I love England, man.
But you know, it's in your blood, and it's what was meant to be, man. Because you know, you're not faking it. This is your blood, bro. You know.
Well, I mean, again, it takes one to know one. I mean, this is what Gene Simmons, man. We used to talk really in detail all the time. You know, because if everyone doesn't know this, but I'm sure they do, Gene was a school teacher, man. The guy is very, very intelligent, and we used to have these deep conversations all the time. And he used to say, you know, people have their destiny, and you're destined to be what you're going to be. You know, some stars can be fabricated and made, but mostly stars are born. I mean, you know what Gene is, man.
Yeah, he knows.
You know?
Yeah.
He definitely knows. And at the time he discovered me, right around then, he had just discovered Van Halen. I'll never forget the stories, man. You know, and he was working with Dinah Ross, who was his girlfriend, and Gene brought me to Diana, and Diana signed me to her label, and I went on tour with my little Mickey Free band in the 80s, early 80s, with John Brandt, before he was in Cheap Trick, playing with me on bass, with Gene Simmons running the sound, Willie Bass, you would have laughed your butt off. Gene Simmons was, off of tour with Kiss, and he was out on the road with the Mickey Free group and Diana Ross. And Diana Ross just walked in the room, and, you know, at that time, they wanted a princely-looking kind of a guy. Remember, and when Purple Rain and all that stuff came out?
Yeah.
But, man, I was wearing ruffled shirts and bell-bottoms, man, and when I was 17, trying to emulate Jimmy, so I didn't even know who Prince was. Man, I didn't even know who he was, you know? And when they put my guitar up on the wall in the Hollywood Hard Rock, I was inducted under the wall. And Little Steven, he and Cheap Trick, they sent videos and congratulate me. And Steven, man, he said the funniest shit, Willie Bays. I mean, I got a copy of it. I've got to get it to you so you can just put the audio out. You know, he was so freaking funny about it. He starts off by saying, "Mickey, I want to let everyone know that you're the son of Little Richard. I discovered you. Prince learned after you. Oh, my God. And Jimi Hendrix, they all copy you." He was rolling. I've got to get you a copy. He would die laughing. He says, "I wish I could be with you now, but I'm filming the last episodes of that TV show he was doing, you know, the gangster show, The Sopranos. We'll party. We'll party when it's done." And that was a couple years ago when they put me up on the wall. So, oh, my God. It was so funny, man.
Yeah.
And you're right, man. Me and you got to do something together, most definitely. We have, like, ships passing in the night. We didn't get to do your benefit that was going to be down at Billboard Live. I was coming. Remember that?
Yeah.
We had a smoking dance in that.
Yeah.
You know? And we think that, you know.
We had fun up at the mansion, though.
Oh, yes, we did.
Yeah.
You're the one, man. You're the one. And the craziest part about it is when you took me up there, all of the rock and roll teachers, they were all of our friends.
They were our friends.
They were everyone.
Hollywood Homecoming.
Everybody. From Vinny to Lee F. Ford to Phil Sasson. I saw Phil he came down for Paladino's. And you know Jimmy DeAnda that used to be with Bullet Boy?
Yeah.
It was his birthday party, so
he
jammed it. Oh, yeah, it was wicked, man. I wanted you to come so bad. It was all over Facebook, and it was packed. It was packed.
Cool.
And if you would have showed up, I'd have drugged your butt up there. Prescott now from the Nat played bass with me. He's a monster.
Love Prescott,
he's a monster,
man.
Yeah. But it would have been smoking, man. We could have hit something, hit it hard, ripped faces off like you do.
Yeah.
You know, you could have sang one, but there's more. We got more coming. I'm around.
The best is yet to come, for sure.
Yeah.
Well, man, I want to wish you luck. I wish that I could come up to Vegas and hang, but I'll catch one of the shows. And I mean, I just love everything that you do, man. And it's great to have you back in L.A. And
I
know there's going to be more.
It's good to be back. You know, and. You know, the music business is not the same as we used to know to do it, but one thing never changes is rock and roll, man. It's live or die, baby. And, you know, that's what we do.
Yeah.
You know, if nothing else, let's try to hook up December the 4th at the House of Blues. ZZ Top's playing, and Billy's invited me down. And so make sure you
here
call
in LA?
Me. Yeah. House of Blues on Sunset.
Cool.
December the 4th. ZZ Top's playing, and I got to go. I got to get paid.
Got to get paid.
Yeah, I got to see my man. That's my boy, Billy Gibbons.
Yeah, man. Yeah, boy.
You know, so I'll be down there, me and Sammy Sanchez. You know all the guys.
Oh, yeah.
And Sammy and, you know, Gavin.
And Mendes, the Hawk, man.
Oh, yeah.
Did you know that Hawk was in a version of Black Sheep? Did he ever tell you that?
Yes, he did. Yeah, man, he told me. Black Sheep, man, that was a cutting edge, killer ass band. Oh, yeah. That's what I'm saying. This shit is so incestuous, man.
Yeah, small world. Small world. I'm really excited about you and John. I've been, you know, following him, and he was talking about you in an interview that he did with Mitch over at Brave Words. And, you know, it's just cool, man. Everything's cool. I'm loving it right now.
Yeah.
Loving it.
Yeah, I love Mitch, man. He's smoking.
Yeah.
You know, me and Mitch used to be in a band together. You know that, right?
No. What?
You didn't know that. You're talking about Mitch Perry,
no,
right?
No, I was talking about Mitch LaFon, but Mitch Perry is out with Lita Ford, and I interviewed him a few weeks back. But you and Mitch Perry were in a band together?
Yeah, in the early 80s, man. Is that crazy?
What was the band?
It was my band, Mickey Free Group, you know? Yeah, and Mitch was a guitar player.
Unbelievable. This is one of the tales from the Sunset Strip right here. So he was in an incarnation of Free.
No doubt. And I mean, man, I mean, we could talk. We don't have enough time to talk. I mean, Frankie Benelli, I played with Frankie as a drummer. Rudy Sarzo, I mean, the original drummer, you're going to die when I tell you this, the original drummer for Crown of Thorns before Tony was Ozzy's drummer. I forget.
Randy Castillo
was our original drummer.
Really?
Yes. Yes.
That's my boy, man.
In Crown of Thorns, he was the original drummer.
Wow, I can't even imagine. That was must have been, like you were saying, that funky but rock, dude.
Yeah, man. I loved Randy. You know, he was part native, too. And yes. He was just an amazing human being and drummer, man.
You know, Randy never, ever tripped on me, dude. He was always 100% cool.
Yeah, always. You know? He's a great drummer, too, man.
Yeah, great human being. Great drummer. Man, rest in peace. Was, yeah, you know, he got inducted into the Smithsonian.
Yes.
And that's really cool.
And you know, I'm there too. And, you know, remember last year at NAMM when they inducted me into the, I was the first Native American to be inducted into the oral history library of NAMM, man. That was really, really a moving moment. I saw you there. Was it, I think it was 2010 when I saw you down there. Yeah, man. I mean, people, our viewers and fans can just go to online and Google it, NAMM, the old history library. They got your boy in there too, man. Besides winning a Grammy. I mean, if I made all the money from these stupid awards I made, I'd be rolling hard, Willie Bay. Right?
Oh, man. I gotta love it. Gotta love it.
Oh, shit, man.
Well, man, you I want you to kill him on Saturday night. I know you will.
You know? I will be having fun. I will be thinking of you, wishing you were there to share the love. But, you know, as like you said, there's much more to come. I'm around. You're around. We will hook up.
Cool, man. All right. Well, I love you. I love you, man. And be good.
I love you too, Willie.
Thank you
so
much.
I love you too, my brother. You got it, man. I'll talk to you later.
All right. Take care.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye. Mickey Free, Tales from the Sunset Strip, thesunsetstriponline.com.